which I continue to do. I got involved with a theater program when my daughter started at Lafayette in 08. So I've been involved with the theater program. She has graduated. So since she has graduated, and I have yet to leave the high school. But my whole goal when I work with a theater program is to make to bring the Broadway shows that we put on from Broadway to the stage of Lafayette. And in doing that, it gives the students, the theater students, actors and actresses and dancers, the feel that they're in New York and on Broadway. And in doing that, with the amount of space that we have, which is very limited, as you guys know, it's very difficult to do that. I do the set building and set design, so I come up with the vision of these pieces that have to be on stage. And when sometimes we have a hard time, you know, maneuvering these pieces on the stage, and I understand there's not a whole lot we can do about that, but building on stage, storing things after shows, and also as we share the stage with others like choral and the orchestra, we have to be able to put those pieces somewhere when those events are going on. So it would be great if we had some area. We've did some modification with one of the areas in the building that has helped a lot, but we could certainly use more space where we could actually build off of the stage, so you know we're not scuffing it up too bad, and then be able to bring it on stage. So I ask you guys to consider these comments when you make your decisions regarding the budget. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mayor.
Lisa Onby.
Good evening, school board members. Dr. Constantino, I wanted to start by thanking you for coming yesterday to the open house at Lafayette. It was great to chat with you. I had my volleyball mom hat on yesterday and wanted to thank the school board for highlighting and recognizing the need for what I'm going to call significant capital improvements with regard to infrastructure at Lafayette. Field lighting, auxiliary gym, a safe pathway to WISC, and just want to stress the importance of actually finding the monies to pay for that. It's wonderful that it's in the upcoming CIP, but many of us have some concerns about how we're going to pay for it. And as much as I hate to bring this up, I think we might need to consider the fourth middle school, particularly as it relates to our auxiliary gym. If we lose James Blair, and there isn't funding found for our auxiliary gym, that's going to hugely impact Lafayette. We use James Blair's gym on a regular basis. So again, more of the need for our auxiliary gym to be funded and not just in the plan. 18 years ago, Lafayette had a plan. I think that's the same plan that's in the CIP for an auxiliary gym. It was in the CIP, but then it wasn't funded. So I can't stress enough. I think we do have to, as much as the fourth middle school train looks like it's left the station, maybe we need to put the brakes on because there continue to be some issues, particularly now as it relates to the improvement projects that we have at Lafayette. I know that the school board doesn't take your fiduciary responsibility lightly, and so as much as you can consider the community's concerns about the cost of the fourth middle school and how we're going to weigh all of the needs that we have. And Lafayette was built in 1972. I think at this point it's fair, it's our turn to have some parity with War Hill and with Jamestown. Our gym is the size of a middle school gym, quite frankly. So again, the need for an auxiliary gym and to make those infrastructure improvements, I can't say enough how much we need to find the monies to do that. So thanks again for your support and looking at how we're going to find the funding to do it all, essentially. Nothing is superfluous when it comes to our budget, but Lafayette needs to take precedence. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Sonia.
Lauren Tappan.
Good evening, Chairman Kelly, Board, and Dr. Constantino. My name is Lauren Tappan, and I'm a teacher at DJ Montague Elementary. As we begin another budget discussion this year, I'm reminded of last year's budget process. Tonight, I want to share my experience to give the board and the public a picture of what all these numbers really mean. Last year, in the final approved budget, it was reported that there was an average 2.5% raise for teachers. The key word, average. For me, a younger teacher, my raise was 0.5%, which equals just $204 for the entire year. As we all know, insurance increased last year. Mine doubled. So even though I did receive a raise, I'm taking home less pay every month. Every month when I see that I have less money, I can't help but ask myself, why am I here? I know why I'm a teacher. It's for the students. I come to school every day for them. The real question is, why am I here in Williamsburg? Why not be a teacher somewhere else? You talk about wanting to be competitive with other divisions. You talk about wanting high-quality teachers. You talk about valuing the teachers you have. I don't feel valued here. In a sad way, I'm thankful to have an extra $200 this year because many teachers didn't receive any raise, yet everybody's insurance increased. While you consider the budget and pay scale this year, or for next year, I ask you to consider what other increases will affect a teacher's take-home pay. I ask you to think beyond the big budget numbers and remember how your decisions will affect individual employees, just like myself. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Ms. Tevin. Those are all the comments, cards we have for the public hearing. If you turned in a card, it'll be called during the regular school board meeting. So with that, I will adjourn the public hearing and reconvene for our regular meeting. First order of business is to take the roll. Before Mrs. Serza takes the roll, I'd like to welcome Mary Miner as our Palatine District School Board representative through sometime in the November time frame, I think. So I appreciate you stepping up and the work that we're going to expect from you. Ms. Serza.
Dr. Beers.
Here.
Ms. Cook.
Here.
Ms. Hummel.
Here.
Ms. Miner.
Here.
Mrs. Taylor.
Here.
Mrs. Young.
Here.
Mr. Kelly.
Here. Brings us to 5.01, approval of the agenda. Can I have a motion for approval of the agenda?
Mr. Chair, I move approval of the agenda as presented.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? It's been moved and seconded for approval of the agenda. Ms. Serza?
Ms. Hummel.
Aye.
Ms. Miner.
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor.
Aye.
Mrs. Young.
Aye.
Dr. Beers.
Aye.
Ms. Cook.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye. 6.01, announcement superintendent's report. Dr. Constantino.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, member of this board. Good evening, everyone. As a service project, the National Junior Honor Society members of Berkeley Middle School joined Safe Routes to School to promote pedestrian safety. Through videos and posters, they launched a leap year campaign to remind their classmates to look before they leap, because YOLO, you only live once. The videos are posted on both the Berkeley Middle and Division websites. As the board is aware, SHIP recently hosted a Chef's Challenge where new dishes were developed for future school lunch menus. At War Hill High School's March of the Lions Community Expo Food Festival 2016, on Saturday, March 12th, our community will have an opportunity to taste these very dishes. Taste testing will be from 11 a.m. to 12:30 p.m. The event is free and open to the public. This week, our elementary schools are celebrating Read Across America with many events and activities. Schools have invited guest readers, will hold character parades, and will commemorate Dr. Seuss's birthday tomorrow, March 2nd. In its 19th year, this annual event is designed to motivate students and celebrate reading. In WJCC, Read Across America brings community members into our schools and gives them an opportunity to share their love of reading with our students, and we thank them for it. Mr. Chair, those are all the announcements I have this evening.
Thank you, Dr. Constantino. Any other announcements from the board? I look forward to the classrooms that I'm going into tomorrow to read, and I hope they don't give me a real complicated Dr. Seuss book, because they can get a little tough. That brings us to 7.01, citizens' comments. Dr. Beers?
Well, here we are again. It is at this particular point in our meeting where citizens are invited to address the board. Those citizens desiring to speak have submitted speaker cards to the clerk prior to the start of tonight's meeting. These speakers are asked to come to the podium when their names are called, state your names for the record, and direct your comments to the chair of the board. It's the board's interest and desire that all comments are heard and respected. Hence, citizens are asked to not engage in applauding, verbal outbursts, or any other type of demonstrations during a presentation. Personal matters are not considered in public meetings. Therefore, the board requests that all speakers refrain from making reference to specific individuals in any form or fashion. Though the board does not respond to your comments are heard and appreciated. Each speaker is allocated 3 minutes to make their presentation, and the board asks that you respect this time limitation. Also, please be reminded that no time may be yielded to another speaker. Your acceptance and adherence to these guidelines will be greatly appreciated. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have concluded my directions.
Thank you, Dr. Beers. I feel like I've heard that before. Mr. Cook. Mrs. Cook.
Jay Everson.
Jay Everson, 103 Branscombe Boulevard in the Berkeley District, ably represented by Mrs. Young. Back in the late 60s, General Patrick Moynihan famously observed that you're entitled to your own opinion, but you're not entitled to your own set of facts. And what I have presented to you here is some facts. The first one is from your approved budget of last year, approved by the City Council, this board, and James City County. It's a five-year CIP. It's on page 2, if you'll note the highlighted portion. The CIP is based on the low projected enrollments going forward. This is a pretty big change, because last I heard and understood, James Blair repurposing is being based on the most likely. And the next page, 3, shows you the impact of the difference between a low enrollment projection and a most likely. This chart here has the capacity of 2571 for the middle schools. You can see in September of 2018 when the school opens, we'll have 167 kids for a 600 school, a student school, which, and 167 doesn't even fill up the annex. Now, if you use most likely, you have 246. That fills the annex, but it's 40% of the James Blair repurposed facility. Now, if you take these numbers out, 10 years to 2024, you will see that on your low projection, you have 163 kids for a 600-unit school. And you will have, that doesn't even, again, fill up the annex. The most likely, of course, is 492. The reason I bring this up, in the next two pages, have the projections from the future think for the low and for the high. When you see the difference here between the numbers, the facts are now in question. We can have our opinion on what we should do about the school, but the facts, we have two tracks. So which set of facts are we going to make our decisions on? Tonight in section 9.02, you're being asked to commit funds for the construction manager. It seems to me that this should be tabled or deferred until such time as the central office can figure out which one of these set of facts we're operating on so that you can make a reasonable judgment and form a reasonable opinion based on those facts. Because after all, you know, why would we want to spend a bunch of money
Thank
on
you,
a school
Mr. Everson,
where we have
it.
Existing capacity? Thank you. I'm sorry to go over.
Jennifer Cottrell. Good evening, members of the board, Mr. Kelly and Dr. Constantino. Thank you again for providing this forum. I'm here as a proud Lafayette Theater parent, following up on what Dr. Maris had started. And I'm sure there are discussions that we're not privy to and decisions that exceed, you know, what we need to know. It's hard for me as a parent taking my child to school and participating in supervision of events involved with the theater to understand why the 900 building that's available at Lafayette is not really available to a lot of the students. It seems like to me a inexpensive and logical way for the theater and other programs at Lafayette to be able to use space on the property. We have, and Dr. Mayers mentioned construction of sets and storage. We have lots of costumes and props and things that we don't have anywhere to put. My fellow props co-chair is here, and we store things in our cars and our houses until such time as we can take them to the school for productions. The theater involves a lot of students. It's almost the whole school year that it's involved. It's not like just a season of sports. It's the whole school, almost the whole school year. It structures their time every day after school on the weekends. It's a healthy program. The kids succeed in theater. They're encouraged to succeed academically. They're high achievers, and they need space to have privacy to change clothes so that we can have the storage for the materials that they're needed to keep on succeeding and experiencing that joy of the theater and of expressing themselves, learning the history of the shows. It's just a well-rounded program for the kids, and we just need space. There is space at Lafayette, and I would like for us to be able to use it. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
John Magda.
Good evening, Mr. Kelly and the board. John Magda, 2903 Richard Pace in the Berkeley District. Happily represented by Mrs. Young. Thank you. Heard a word today from a Zimbabwe slang. We've heard of Nicodemus. Nicodemus, of course, mentioned in the Bible from the book of John. And it was also mentioned in the book of memory by Petrina Gappa. Okay, Nicodemus Lee is the slang. It's an adverb, as in performing an act of malice at night or under cover when no one's looking. I present that word. It's an awful word that I hope we don't see much of. Apathy, another great word. We all know apathy. Political apathy, social apathy. Fight apathy, or don't. Is that apathy? President Truman once said, even when one American who has done nothing wrong is forced by fear to shut his mind and close his mouth, then all Americans are in peril. I ask you to think about that. Please, open your minds. Don't be in fear. In light of the recent media coverage, James City citizens do believe the school board has to blame for some concern problems. Of course, the citizens seem to have a certain amnesia, seeming to remember who elected the board. Our hope is to change that fight. And as we continue on, elect citizens' choices who will behind and support the citizens. Speak about my daughter real quick. Recent child services psychologist interview from the school found out her family does love her, and this was enforced. She does matter. She is a winner. Her life makes a positive difference, despite what she was told. And the one that really gets is left-handed people are not misfits, okay? I point that out. Some lyrics from Rachel Platten. It's called Fight Song. This is my fight song. Take back my life song. Prove I'm all right song. My power's turned on. Starting right now, I'll be strong. I'll play my fight song. And I really don't care if nobody else believes, because I've still got a lot of fight in me. And it's one of my daughter's favorites. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mack.
Sandra Magda. Excuse me.
Good evening. I wanted to some things that my husband and I have learned over the last week is a little rumor going around, which we find quite interesting, is that we have a lawsuit filed against WJCC. That is not true. What we have is legal counsel, and that is to get the answers that we asked for May 18th. And the three things we asked for were an apology on record, an acknowledgement of the facts of what happened to our daughter, and a complete and accurate bully report. When the WJCC attorney contacted our legal counsel last week, he asked what we wanted. Her response was the same three items listed in her 32-page complaint. WJCC attorney responds with, "That will never happen." Really? You don't think my 8-year-old daughter, who spent 3 months at school being verbally abused and then finally physically assaulted, doesn't deserve an apology? This isn't about money. This is about acceptance and accountability for you and for your administration at the school that she was mistreated at. We don't want anything. We still want the same three things we wanted May 18th. We got a complete and accurate report. Sadly, it's backdated. I have two reports here. I have the May 18th, 2015 report, which is incomplete. I have our $9,000 report from our attorney, dated May 18th. It's complete, but it's backdated. Documentation. Why? Why is this so difficult? I don't understand why you can't, anybody, why anybody can't just say, things didn't go as they should. We're sorry. You have a community of parents attending Clara Bird Baker that are uncomfortable. If you don't think you owe us an apology, you can at least confirm to them that things will be different next time. I shouldn't be forced out of our school. And also today I find out by few staff that our family's being monitored when we attend school with our children. Monitored. Really? I can't even go to my children's school. Something needs to change. And I just want these three things complied with.
Matthew Willem.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, Dr. Constantino, and members of the board. I am here to officially thank you. Lafayette High School is thrilled that all seven of our elected school board members were able to attend our open house yesterday. It shows your level of commitment for our entire community and that you have been listening to our requests that are in the CIP, and we are thrilled for that. So thank you on behalf of the Lafayette community. It meant a lot to us. We continue to go down the path of the funding discussions, and we also invited members of our Board of Supervisors to the same open house, and we're happy to say the majority of them were also able to attend. And now I think we begin to think about creativity in light of capacity issues that exist with the demolition of James Blair coming. And so one thing that we just wanted to put on the table was the opportunity for a spending plan request to begin early construction of the auxiliary gym that is needed to meet the capacity. Clearly, I don't know how all this works, so I'm putting it on the table for your consideration. We did see that the spending plan request was partly filled in November to the Board of Supervisors, and then representatives said they would return in January, and we've been inquiring with different government officials and elected officials really in all areas to see if it would be a possibility. And it seems like it's something that can be discussed. So we just wanted to encourage that discussion wherever it's appropriate for you. So again, thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
takes us to 8.01, personnel actions. Can I have a motion for approval of the personnel actions as presented tonight?
Mr. Chair, I move approval of item 8.01, personnel actions as presented.
Is there a second? Any discussion? It's been moved and seconded for approval of the personnel actions as presented tonight. Mrs. Cerza?
Mrs. Taylor? Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Dr. Beers? Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Ms. Miner?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. That brings us to 9.01, Title I Supplemental Reading Material. Dr. Constantino?
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. Staff is here this evening to request purchase for Title I Supplementary Literacy Intervention Materials for elementary students. And Mr. Thorpe is here to take you through the agenda item.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Dr. Constantino. Tonight we submit an expenditure for leveled literacy intervention kits that would support some primary readers in our school division. Earlier this winter, our data identified a number of kindergarten through grade two students in our schools who were reading below grade level and who could benefit from additional supports and intervention. With input from school stakeholders, we selected LLI, which is an evidence-based intervention program to support readers who are in need at our elementary schools who receive Title I services. LLI provides small group intervention designed for children who find reading and writing to be difficult. LLI is designed to bring children quickly up to grade level in 14 to 18 weeks on average. This expenditure is an expansion of our LLI kits in our school division and adds to our inventory and ensures total coverage for students who are in need in grades kindergarten through grade two in our Title I schools. The amount of the purchase is $73,362 and will be paid through the Title I grant. As per school board policy, the school board must approve all purchases over $50,000. We are grateful for your consideration for this purchase. Do you have any questions for us?
Questions from board members? Dr. Beers.
I'm curious, how does this dovetail with the reading recovery program?
That's a great question. Thank you. With our reading recovery program, we identify our first grade students who are most in need of reading instruction, and reading recovery then provides one-to-one instruction for those students who can be seen by our reading recovery teachers at all of our schools. These supports are for additional students who are more close to grade level in grade one, and then our kindergarten and second grade students who are working below grade level as well.
Would these books be used by the teachers of those kids, or would they be used by other personnel that are working with them?
Part of our reading recovery teacher's job is not just working with first grade, but also providing groups for grade two and kindergarten as well. So in addition to reading recovery teachers providing LLI interventions, we would also have tutors paid for through Title I provide that service as well. And those tutors have been or will be trained in LLI.
And trained by the reading recovery teachers?
They'll actually be trained by certified level literacy intervention trainers.
And do the reading recovery teachers have access to these books as well?
They do. Yes, sir.
Mr. Thorpe, I'd like to just confirm the amount. Is it $73,262.63? I just want to make sure I understand that.
Yes, I didn't include the cents. Sorry.
I just think I got some numbers switched in my mind. And I just want to thank you for using data to inform this type of work. I'm very excited that you're doing that. So thank you. So great.
Any other questions from board members? Thank you, Mr. Thorpe. That takes us to 9.02, RFP number 16-6864, Construction Management Services for James Blair Middle School. Dr. Costantino.
Chair, members of the board, this is a placeholder agenda item that we're still in the process of finalizing the RFP for construction management services, but Mr. Snipes is here to take you through the agenda item this evening. Mr. Snipes.
Good evening, Dr. Constantino, members of the board chair. WJCC is seeking construction management services to support the school division's project team in the construction of James Blair Middle School. Construction management services include and support include support and assistance with on-site management team for the duration of the project, a monthly update to the school board on the construction progress, a document review of constructability, a construction milestone schedule, pre-bid and post-bid conferences, a review of the construction contract, and recommendations regarding all proposed change orders. A request for proposal was issued on January 8th with a due date of February 5th. Notice of the RFP was on the James City County bulletin board, emailed to contractors, placed on the James City County and Williamsburg James City County Public School websites. And as Dr. Constantino said, this is a placeholder agenda item at this time.
Questions from board members, comments?
I have a comment.
Mrs. Miner had her hand up, so I'll get Mrs. Miner and then I'll come back to Mrs. Young.
How many RFPs, responses to the proposal did we receive?
Received approximately seven RFPs, responses.
Seven RFP.
Mrs. Young.
Okay, this is in response to this. I received today information that was sent out from Dr. Constantino to school board members about two documents. One of these talked about, the first document contained information about school use capacity information. The second one was the repurposing of the James Blair building, the annex. So I'm just going to read what I wrote, but after assessment of the information on the budget, which is, I have handy right here, on page 132, 133, and 139, there's conflicting information as far as the future thing. So it does not appear that the projected enrollment substantiate the necessity for a new middle school. The shortfall in 2020 is 272 students, according to this, the figures that are in here. This, however, is without the use of the annex at James Blair. So we're looking at 272 students without having a place. However, we're not using the annex currently for our own students, a building that was designed for students. So in preparation for our March 15th meeting, when I'm sure we're going to be addressing this again, since this is a placeholder, I would like the school division staff to provide more information to the school board about the projected enrollment. I would like accurate figures and to explain what would be required to bring the annex back into use to meet the shortfall. And I have read both documents rather thoroughly, but I feel like some of the information in them is not quite accurate and doesn't exactly address what needs to happen in the event that we chose to use the annex to support these students in our school division, and would save a lot of money for the citizens of this county not to have to put all that money into a new school building. So, Mr. Snipes, I know you're really good at your job. Could you perhaps bring forth a little bit more information to us at the instruction of Dr. Constantino?
Yes, at the instruction of Dr. Constantino, we will do so. Ms. Berta is also responsible for some of those future thinking.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Ms. Berta.
Yes, Mr. Chair, thank you. I'm excited to consider this and take action on it at our next meeting. I have a question about the intersection of the construction management work and the value engineering, and is there an intersection there? Are they completely two separate things that, you know, the value engineering then feeds into the construction management, or do they have input on the value engineering piece? Is there any intersection there?
There is no intersection between the value engineering and the construction management piece. The construction management will deal with constructability, as stated in the agenda item, but there is no intersection there.
So they don't have any input on whatever decisions? Okay.
They just manage the project for us.
The value engineering, Mr. Chair, I realize this is slightly off topic. I appreciate your allowing me just, at what point are we going to hear the results of the value engineering? We know it happened, but I don't think we've heard what you decided to recommend. So is that coming at any point to us?
There's a meeting schedule. The architects are returning. I don't know the date off the top of my head. It could be the next meeting. I don't want to I don't have it in front of me, but we have a plan to have the architects return at the 65% and also the final value engineering.
And they were, I think they're supposed to, the value engineered items that they were considering, they were supposed to give us a spreadsheet about what they considered, and I think that was something that we, the board asked for. Just to make sure we understand what...
Yes, sir.
Dr. Beers.
As I recall, there were 20 items that were identified by the value engineering group that they felt were significant. And I remember in the discussion, the architectural firm saying they would get together with a committee and decide which ones would be best to forward. I made the request then, and if this is a little out of order, I'm sorry. I'd like to see all 20 of those, because I'd like to know what the cost analysis was for each one of those.
Yeah, we have that. Any other comments from board members on the construction management? I think this is a good thing to do, and the best way for us to make sure that we get a quality middle school, having the construction management services out there on a daily basis to make sure that our school is being built the way we want it to. So, thank you. 9.03, IFB number 168678, Matthew Whaley Auditorium HVAC replacement. Dr. Constantino.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. Mr. Snipes remains at the podium this evening to talk about the auditorium HVAC replacement bid and RFP. Go ahead.
The HVAC system at Matthew Whaley was installed in 1986. It's currently 10 years past its 20-year useful life. In FY14, the CIP approved a project which included the base bid for Matthew Whaley, which was the chiller, and an alternate base bid for the auditorium for the replacement of the HVAC in the auditorium. The scope of work of this project includes removal of the existing air conditioning air handler units in the auditorium, as well as removal and replacing of the condensing units. An invitation for bid was sent out on January 13th with the due date of February 2nd. Notice of the IFB was posted on the James City County website, as well as the school board's website.
Question from board members, Mrs. Cook?
Yep. Mr. Snipes, I just want to confirm that this is in the cost budgeted section. It says it's in the capital improvement budget. Hi, Ms. Berta. I just want to, is it fiscal year 16 CIP that this is in?
It's actually fiscal year 14
okay.
CIP that it's included.
Okay.
There is the need for additional funding to support the entire project, which we have requested through the city and county to transfer funds from completed CIP projects so that we can have the ample funding necessary to complete this project at this time.
Thank you for the clarification.
It would be helpful for me to see the funding of the CIP and what we have as carryover from other projects, just to sort of get my head wrapped around all of the cost.
Mr. Snipes, but I don't think you're going anywhere. 9.04, contract award for the security camera system upgrade project. Dr. Constantino.
Chair, members of the board, Mr. Price.
Again, the school division safety and security committee is charged with continuous monitoring of division security equipment, practices, and procedures. A committee created a security standard recommending areas of the facilities that should be monitored both interior and the exterior of our sites. The staff, and Mr. Brian Weaver is here, applied for and received a safety security equipment grant from the Virginia Department of Education. That grant totaled $67,200. We have to provide a 25% match in order to receive the grant. The grant will assist us with the purchase and installation of equipment at James River, Toano, and Norge. Office Pro Technologies is the approved vendor for telecommunications repairs and services under our contract number 15-6784. The total projected cost is $108,153. The project is funded from a combination of grant money, operating budget, and a requested transfer from the city and county. And Ms. Berta can answer specifics in regards to those transfers.
Questions Mrs. Hummel.
I just have a general question of why those three schools?
Those three schools were deemed by the standard to be the most needy at this time.
So are there no security cameras at the other schools or just a different?
No, we have security cameras at all.
Okay, so you got them at all of our schools?
Yes, ma'am.
But these three schools needed?
Based on the standard for the what we need interior and exterior, these three were deemed as the most needy at this present time.
Additional cameras?
These are additional cameras.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Yeah, I have another financial question. The local match, is that's coming from our current operating budget?
Correct.
And was that budgeted?
It's coming from operations and maintenance savings from different efficiencies that we found in their department. At the time the budget was developed, we weren't aware of the grant and the requirement for the match, but we don't want to give up money that we're able to get through the state.
And then the transfer from the city and the county for the James River HVAC and for the Rawlsburg perimeter are from which fiscal year CIP? I should know that.
2014.
2014, mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Any other questions from board members? Thank you, Mr. Snipes. I think you can sit down now. 9.05 budget discussion. As a member of the school board of Williamsburg, James City County, I acknowledge that I have an interest in the fiscal year 2016-2017 school budget because my wife is an employee of the WJCC schools. However, I believe that I am able to participate in the consideration and vote on the budget fairly and in the public interest.
Mr. Chair, as a member of the school board of Williamsburg, James City County, I acknowledge that I have an interest in the fiscal year 2007 budget because I'm an employee of the Williamsburg Health Foundation. However, I believe that I'm able to participate in the consideration and vote on the budget fairly and in the public's interest.
Dr. Constantino.
Thank you. Mr. Chair, members of the board, Mr. Baker is here to provide you information you requested regarding centering mainly on the proposals and ideas associated with employee compensation. Before Mr. Baker speaks, however, I'd like to just go on record with the board and say that this is the earliest that we have ever discussed specific employee compensation. We are sharing with you draft documents of what compensation could be. However, this is all prior to knowing what our funding is. And I would caution the board, I would caution our staff, and I would caution the public not to take these documents and say, this is what's going to happen. So with that slight discomfort in having this conversation so early, I'll let Mr. Baker go ahead and share with you the information that we've pulled together.
Good evening, Mr. Chair, members of the board, Dr. Constantino. I've shared with you a hard copy that includes our current scale, the new scale, and then kind of a way to explain the new scale that's easier to understand. I think that's what y'all were asking for last time. Again, some of the highlights for the scale, we're trying to address compression and also entry-level pay and also staying within our budget. So the new scale, again, has no compression, no multi-year steps. It does make the steps narrower from 2.5% to 1.5%. It does provide opportunity for consistent step increases in the future as long as we budget for that 1.5%. It does increase the starting level teacher salary from to $41,500. It does give an increase to all teachers, even teachers at the top of the scale, because we've expanded the scales, would receive the next available step. The scale that you have in front of you, like I said, there's the current scale, the new scale, and then what we've done is we had an individual sheet for each column that's on the current scale so you could show. I think one of the questions we were getting last time was, you know, what is a teacher going to get, you know, who's earning this year, and what are they going to get next year? And so we've broken it down in the third sheet for you, and it says, you know, bachelor's comparison. And so that's the first column on the current scale. And so it shows you what a bachelor's someone this year is making on the bachelor scale, and then what they would make next year on the scale. And then we go through each of the six columns on the current scale. So then bachelor's plus 15, what are they making this year? What are they making next year? Master's degree this year, next year, master's plus 15, and so on. So the teachers that have been compressed on the current scale will be moved to the appropriate step on the new scales. Teachers at the top of the scale or have been capped in the past, since we've expanded the scales, they will receive the next available step. We're creating a new step, so they will get a new step. We went back through the entire scale with all the current employees to make sure we've considered everybody and every possible teacher, and we confirmed that all the teachers are receiving a range from the lowest end of 1.41% increase to the high end of 6.54% increase is the range for the teachers on this scale. So we can fix compression and ensure that all employees all the teachers that are currently capped can move up to the next additional step. But because of compression in the past, not all the steps are equal. So we've given that to you, and I don't know if I can answer any questions for you.
Questions from board members? Mrs. Miner?
I have one that has less to do with this proposed schedule, but I went exploring as I tend to do, and I learned that some divisions actually pay teachers for different contract days, and I was wondering what the impact of that, Newport News being the division, what is the impact of that? Is that different than giving stipends to teachers for coming in and doing curriculum writing and other things over the summer? And do stipends count towards the VRS payment? I guess this might be a larger question.
Stipends do not count towards the VRS payment because they are inconsistent. Generally, you have teachers that will do it one year and not another. Longevity pay does count towards VRS, but that's the only stipend that does.
Dr. Beers?
Yeah, stay there because I've got a question related to that. The years that teachers got no raises at all, were teachers getting longevity payments?
Yes.
So they were.
Yes.
So even those years when the other teachers received no raises at all, they were continuing to get their longevity payment.
Once the longevity payments were frozen, those remained with those staff members. Yes.
So I just want to.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions about the salary? So I'm sorry, Mr. Baker, I forgot. I didn't get to grab the higher number,
6.54%.
6.54. Is that, I guess that 6.54 is generally for the compression of the teachers at the lower end of the scale?
Correct. So you'll have some teachers that didn't receive anything for 2 years. So it's making up for that.
So this would raise our entire salary structure by 1.5?
Going forward, it would average 1.5.
Well, but for this year's budget, how much what's the percentage?
Our salary line?
Yes.
About 5%.
About 5%. Mm-hmm. Okay.
That's in order to accommodate the correction of compression.
So, and all of this presumes that we are fully funded from our funding bodies for what we are requesting. So if we don't get that full funding request, this all has to be changed and modified and figured on. Dr. Constantino goes to the mic.
I think that if we are not funded at the level that we have requested, depending on the level of funding we do receive, then priorities will have to be reestablished. That would happen normally in May. The process is that the supervisors and city council will set their budgets in April and early May. That information comes back to us in May. And then in May, we would have to make priorities. So my comments at the beginning of this conversation were to simply say, this is not cast in stone. We don't know what we don't know. It's possible that the board could make one of a number of different decisions in May about how to expend the monies that they do get from the localities.
Right. And 5% is what real number?
2.4.
Okay. Okay. Mrs. Hummel.
Does the $2.5 million include the 800-some-thousand longevity pay?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So that's outside of this whole. Okay. And Before, when we were looking at this, there were some people who were going to get less than 1%, but now?
We went back and reevaluated the scale and made it where we could make everyone at least get 1.41%, all the way up to 6.54.
Thank you for doing
that. That was generally those on the higher end of the scale to get the 1.4.
Masters plus 30, if I'm
not. Okay.
But some of those are also getting the longevity pay.
Right. Good. Be potentially.
Potentially. Okay.
Dr. Beers?
Well, if that's the case, would that be converted into a percentage raise?
Longevity
pay?
Yeah,
if you add the longevity plus the 1.5% or whatever it is.
Until such time that there's a decision to change longevity pay, that's going to be a permanent fix in the budget and doesn't even come into the discussion on the salary scale.
And is it the same amount of money every year for them, for
yes.
that teacher? And is there an average figure? Because, you know, I've got the number of teachers and I know the total amount. Do you just divide one by the other, or is there a range?
There's a range. At the time that it was frozen, if a teacher was at 21 years of service, I believe the longevity payment is $3,390. And at the time that it was frozen, if they had 26 years of experience, it was $7,030 annually that the teacher
received. Wait a minute. Somebody getting $7,000 a year?
Yes, sir. It depends on where they were at that point in time when that longevity pay was frozen and stopped.
Right. There was a lot of discussion about longevity. Mrs. Cook.
And I'd just like to confirm that the percentage ranges you're discussing are about the salary scale itself, not inclusive of longevity.
Correct.
So just want to be clear about that.
Mrs. Minor.
So for the other salary ranges, are they getting the 1.5%?
Okay. Admin and support staff, yes.
Admin and support staff. And then the other question is, I believe I asked it, of staff, is there anyone who is at the top of their position value in the admin support staff range?
There is right now, but we're discussing because we're making the effort to give everyone a salary increase, we would extend that range.
Yeah, just one more question about longevity. I know that teachers who've come from another district, maybe they've been 24 years in one district and they've been here for three. Do they get a longevity pay? They get longevity pay, correct?
They did.
If they arrived at the time that longevity pay was given, awarded,
right.
Yes,
okay.
They would have received it.
Okay.
You didn't have to. You didn't have to exclusively work here the whole 26
okay.
years.
When was that number, what year was that we?
I don't recall.
To the best of my recollection, when I first arrived here in the spring of 2011 is when the board heard the report from the Evergreen Consultants, and I believe that the freeze went into effect for the following school year.
So for the 2012-2013 school year.
Or 11-12.
We can find out.
We can find that 12. Out.
You're right. I think it was 11-12. And so nobody has received longevity pay who's joined us past 11-12, the 11-12 school year. Dr. Beers?
Yeah, so I just want to make sure I understand this. Somebody who reaches that point now, that's not available.
Or anybody who has reached that point since 2011 has not been available, or 2012 or whatever.
Well, No new people.
I guess I got some real thoughts about that because I'm really concerned that, and I don't, you know, I know they're really valuable. Somebody getting a $7,000 a year addition to their to their salary every year, when we have teachers who, for a number of years, have gotten virtually no raises at all. I guess I'm surprised that it's as large as it is. I mean, that's what if somebody's making $75,000 and they get a $7,000 raise, that's like 10% a year, isn't it?
A $7,000 raise, just to...
If they get a, if they have a longevity payment, and it's $7,000. You said, didn't you say some of them are getting $7,000? Okay. I'm just pulling a number out of the hat. Let's say their salary is $75,000. They get another $7,000 the next year.
They don't get an additional $7,000. That's a permanent fixed stipend.
Just one time?
No, it's okay. Every year. Yeah, but it's so not additional every year. It's not $7,000 on top of $7,000. But it's a consistent $7,000 stipend.
Year? So what would it be the next year?
It would still be $7,000.
Yeah. On top of their base.
Okay, that's right. What I said. So that's like, you know, just less than a 10%. If we called it see, we're talking about dollars, and you know, we talk about percentage, we talk about raise, we talk about longevity, but in the final analysis, we're talking dollars. And if somebody's making 75, they get a 7,000, longevity payment. That's like for somebody else, a raise of almost 10%, and nobody gets 10% raises. So I didn't realize it was that high. So I'm educated.
Okay. Mrs. Hummel?
I just had a question. I'm assuming that these percentages are on their base salaries, not their base salaries plus their longevity.
Correct.
I would just like to say that I appreciate the work that you did to propose this fixing of compression because it makes the salaries more equitable across the system for our instructional staff, particularly for our newer teachers. I think the current system disproportionately and negatively impacts our newer teachers, especially those hired since the recession. And so I really appreciate your looking at this and attempting to stop that negative impact on those teachers. So thank you.
Anyone have any comments on the salary structure that is proposed if we get fully funded and going to be different if we don't get fully funded? But talks to the philosophy of how we're doing. Now, some of the future think projections that we look at and for four future budgets, we use the low number from future think because that's a conservative as far as dollars that you come to the school system. If we use most likely, that could give us a potentially an inflated number of, or gives us a larger number. So it's not the most conservative value as far as revenue for the school system,
right,
which is why we use the low number. Now, so we've used Future Think or whatever it was before that for many years. And do we have a feel for how close they have come for the past years on their most likely number?
On the most likely number or on the low number?
On the most likely number.
No, I don't. On the low number, they've been within 1%.
So generally speaking, they're within 1% of the low number. I'm not sure how that compares to the most likely number.
Find out.
But their 1% was more?
It could be plus or minus 1% is how close they've been for us in
funding.
On
the low number. Mm-hmm. For the last?
5 years.
5 years. Got it. Any other? Mrs. Young.
I just have a question. I was looking on page 132 of the budget, and you have a chart here about actual and projected enrollment, and you're saying that's 1% either way. Do you have the actual figures as far as, I mean, what you projected and compared to what actually happened in the schools at some point? Could you give us those numbers?
Yeah.
I'd like to see them. Thank you. Thank you for all your hard work, too.
For how long of a period
of
time?
Well, you started back here in 2006, so from maybe 2006 up to the current school year.
So, Mr. Chair, I just would like to say that I am prepared to... cast a vote on this budget at our next meeting. And I'm not sure if how our colleagues feel about that. But, you know, as the budget as a policy document, it took us a long time to bottom out in the recession, and it's going to take us a long time to dig out. And so we can't solve everything in one budget year. I'd like to see more pre-K. I'd like to see us not have to re-smooth our bus replacement plan. I'd like to see more investment in administration at the building level. I'd like to see more investment in operations, per the Faithful and Gold study. But I think fixing compression, it's a pretty big ticket item, but I think it's a really good place to start because, as we heard here tonight, we have to invest in our teachers because that's the best investment we can have for our children. So that's what I think we need to do. And we're required to present a budget of need, and I think we could present a budget of more need, certainly, but I think this does that. So I thank you for the work, and I think we should support what's been presented to us.
Thank you. Any other comments from board members? Thank you. That takes us to 10.01, revision policy IIBEA. Oh, it is, because it's alphabetical. IIBEA, GAB, acceptable technology system use policy. Mrs. Cook and or Mrs. Young.
Can I take it
from you? Sure, go right ahead. Mr. Chair, if you would indulge us for a moment to talk about the policies in general and the policy
Please.
Committee. We wanted to give our colleagues an update. So Mrs. Young and I met with Dr. Constantino and Dr. Heron and Ms. Serza and some other staff members and discussed the idea that best practice suggests that school boards should review their policies at least every 5 years. So if we use that as a pacing guide, then we should review approximately 5 policies every month, and then that would get us through a cycle every 5 years. And that, of course, doesn't count any policies, new or altered, that need to be reviewed based on changes or law or other external influences. So with that in mind, Mrs. Young and I have agreed, and we hope that you will support us, that we will bring 5 to 10 policies to you each month for your consideration so that we can stay current with that best practice in mind. The policies we propose will be reviewed at work sessions like this one and then put into the consent agenda for the next meeting. If any board member would like to discuss any policy in more in depth than that, it can and should be removed from the consent agenda per our normal process. The policies will be grouped in the way you see them tonight. They will be new or revised or retired as suggested by staff and reviewed by the two of us. We will also, just as for your information, we'll be reviewing them in comparison to the VSBA, and staff has created quite an elaborate process to make sure that it goes through the appropriate departments within the division and through legal. So by the time it gets here, it will have been fairly well vetted and ready for your questions. So anyway, if you have any questions about that, we'd be delighted to answer them. I'd also like to note that we've asked the policy committee, asked Ms. Serza to bring up the policies related to out-of-zone attendance, and so that will be on our agenda in the next couple of months as it gets through that process that I just discussed.
Okay. Great. Well, I appreciate you and Mrs. Young taking the task at hand of 5 to 10 policies a month. That's that's a good on you is all I got to say. Mrs. Young?
I just want to add one comment. Some of these policies go back as far as 1974, so the need for update was definite. And the people that we worked with did an amazing job of bringing forth the current information. And so these retired policies, they were already included in newer policies. So it's and Mr. Baker, I think, was part of that. And I forget the other lovely gentleman back there. But I think that we really need, and Dr. Heron was there. And so it's time consuming, but it needs to be done. So we'll just enjoy hearing your comments.
Appreciate you becoming policy wonks in this whole deal. I assume you're here to talk about 10.01.
Yes, sir.
I have a
Mr. Chairman. Dr. Beers.
Do you have a chronology? I don't mean time. Have you prioritized the policies? Which ones are you going to do next? Which ones are you going to do after that?
Well, I think that we'll rely on, to some extent, boards. So, for instance, the AutoZone, but primarily relying on staff and trying to spread that workload because some departments have in excess of 80-100 policies, and so I think we have over 280 policies. So, so they can spread out the work. We're relying on staff to determine prioritization unless something comes from the board. So, if that suits you.
Yeah, because I think it will come from the board. Okay,
Mrs. Hummel.
Just to, if it's possible to speed up the process. So for these.
Are you volunteering, Mrs. Hummel?
No, I'm just looking at the 10.02, 03, 04, 05 that are retired because they are in some other policy. Is it worth just like going through the ones that are up for what you guys would consider retiring and getting those out of the way quickly? Like we could take more than four. We could take like 20.
You can retire four policies at a shot.
I'm just
right?
saying if they're already somewhere else, like just go ahead and I don't know. That's just my thought.
Yeah, a lot of that time you can retire a policy, but you got to add two words into another policy in order to retire this one. And so there's a lot of you really have to make sure that you're systematic and process driven as you review your policies. But I appreciate I appreciate that because I think 280 policies is just about enough, personally.
Mrs. Young was all for 20. I'm the one who sort of said,
she stepped me back a little bit. But the one thing I do want to say is if you look at the documents that were presented, not only are the newer policies there, but the old policy also. So there's two different documents that you're looking at. And there was a lot of work invested by staff in this process, and I do definitely thank them. I'm just glad I did not have to do it. I just had to be there.
Mr. Landers, do you have something you want to talk to us about?
Sure. Well, good evening, Mr. Chair, members of the board, Dr. Constantino. I'll be speaking to you tonight about the recommended revised policy, IIBEA-GAB, also known as the division's acceptable use policy. The revisions have been reviewed by the board's policy committee as well as the division attorney. The proposed changes are minor, but they do bring the policy up to date as far as formatting purposes, closer alignment with the Virginia School Board Association's recommended policy, and also some update to language that was becoming outdated. Some examples of those language updates, we changed references to telecommunications, network services, file service, to the more general term of technology. And we changed references to bulletin boards to a more general reference of information resource. So the revisions are minor in nature, but they do bring the policy up to date. And I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Are there any questions on the technology use policy? I think we're good. Thank you.
Thank you.
10.02, retire policy, GCK, professional staff workload. Should I go to Dr. Constantino, or should I just go straight to Mr. Baker?
Good evening, Mr. Baker. These next set of policies are exactly what Mrs. Young just described to you, policies that are covered in other policies, and Mr. Baker and his staff have gone through and determined that we can retire these policies and still have the necessary language for the school board. So I'll let him rip through however fast or slow the board wants to go.
Be real quick. Nothing's changing with our current practice with these. We're just eliminating some duplication because these policies were covered in other areas. We are going to align with VSBA, and our attorney has reviewed it and made these recommendations. The first one is policy GCK, professional staff workload. There is no VSBA policy GCK, professional staff workload. These items actually are covered under our current policy of GAA staff time schedules, and our attorney has recommended that we delete or retire this policy.
Any comments, questions? Keep going.
Next policy is GCJ, professional staff time schedules. There is no VSBA policy, GCJ, professional staff time schedules. Again, this is also covered under our policy, GAA, staff time schedules. and our attorney has recommended we delete this and retire this.
To practice staff time schedules, is that, you seem to be very into that. Next one?
The next one is policy GCLA, professional staff visitation and conferences. There is no VSBA policy GCLA, professional staff visitation and conferences. This is covered under our current GCBDR, a regulation for staff leaves of absence, and more specifically under professional leave, allowing people to go visit other classrooms, other schools. And our attorneys recommended that we delete this or retire this.
I presume that in 1974 or 1984 that there was a policy GCLA from the VSBA?
Must have been.
Okay. Any questions? Dr. Keep going, Mr. Baker.
The last one I have is policy GDC, compensatory leave. There is no VSBA policy GDC, compensatory leave. This is geared towards exempt employees gaining compensatory leave. Not a good practice, but our attorneys recommend that we delete this policy.
I do have a question. For our exempt staff, particularly for the folks that get up at 3, 2, 3, 4 in the morning to go out and travel our roads to see how they are, whether we're going to open and close school, then are we permitting them flex? What's the impact, and how is it going to be operational for those people who like stay to write a grant till 2 in the morning or come in on Saturdays to get that work completed? I understand exempt employees are supposed to work to get work until the work's complete. That's the expectation. But we also know that if they work 90 hours a week, they become less productive. Your attendance fails, they look for other jobs, all of those other kinds of issues arise.
I think it's more of a management issue. I mean, they're not unreasonable. I think if in those types of situations, the way the policy was written, it was actually allowing them to bank that time, and we just don't want to do that. So
operationally, it would be up to each of the managers for those particular exempt employees to make that decision?
Correct.
Thank you, Mr. Baker. So we will put those on the consent agenda for our next meeting to hit those in one fell swoop. That brings us to 11.01, discussion on Robert's Rules of Order for Boards. Dr. Beers.
I forwarded to the board my my analysis of using Robert's Rules for large and small assemblies and or boards. And as I said in my statement, I found merit in both sets of rules, but I really felt that from looking at the rules for both groups, that one set of rules I think was appropriate for the more formal board meetings, but I would very much recommend that we consider using the rules for smaller groups for our work sessions. And I have a statement. I can certainly read it. Do you want me to do that, or
what? Well, it's published on published on the board docs, so it's out there in the domain. And I have board members reviewed it and have any comments, Mrs. Cook?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Dr. Beers, I have a question for you that I wasn't clear about, and I agree with your assessment, and thank you very much for taking the time to do that analysis. But I'm curious if you still envision at the beginning of both meetings, whether it's a work session or a formal meeting, approving the agenda. That's an item that I've felt has been very valuable for the pacing of the work of this body.
Oh, absolutely. I think that's very appropriate, and it works quite well. I think that's important to have that laid out. I'll take a step back, a step forward. I've read a lot about this, and I read a lot about organizations and boards in formal and in informal settings, and especially the term work session. And work session, by many organizations really means that you sit around with your colleagues and maybe you roll your sleeves up. But you have information that's either being presented by board members or it's being presented by staff. And the primary purpose of the work session is to look those over, to have an opportunity to share and discuss whatever documents or ideas or issues are coming up, but also have an opportunity to engage staff and fellow board members, like across the table rather than, you know, around the crescent. I think it's important. I know there are space issues. I actually walked this building, but I think there's some other possibilities of other locations that can accommodate the video auditorium, audio requirements, room for the public, that sort of thing. But I will be disappointed that we can't figure that out. It's like there has to be a way to find a place where we can sit around as a board and talk through issues and just other things that come that I would say are a work session. As far as I can tell, we generally don't take any action at work sessions. It's for information. It's to talk about issues and topics where we, so in many of these things require one, possibly two, sometimes three readings and discussions before it goes to becomes an action item. And we do our action items and I think this is appropriate at a more formal setting. It's like, okay, now we're going to act and we're going to do it in a professional manner. That doesn't mean that when we have work sessions, we're not going to be professional. It just means that it's a little more informal. And if we can see each other, no offense to the chairman, it may not be required to always raise your hand or be recognized by the chair in order to participate in a discussion. Now, he may disagree with me on that, but I think during a work session, I think that that's just one of the things I think that maybe we don't need to do as much of, but we clearly need to do it in a more formal setting. So there it is. Those are my thoughts. Those are my ideas. So have at it.
I'll give you my comments later. Mrs. Hummel.
Okay.
When Mrs. Young and Mrs. Taylor, Dr. Beers and myself attended the Richmond training for new board members, we had a whole section on parliamentary procedure and best practices, and it was recommended as a best practice that work sessions be in a more in the format that Dr. Beers is recommending, to such an extent that I actually flagged down the speaker in between the sessions and had him come over and talk to all of us and say, this is how our work sessions are currently done. Is this a best practice? And he said, no. The best practice is for it to be like Dr. Beers recommended.
Any other comments?
Go ahead.
No, I totally concur with Dr. Beers and Julie and Mrs. Hummel, because I feel like that during these work sessions we should be able to have a lot of discussion and it shouldn't be so formal, and I would really like everybody to participate, and if we sat around a table and talked, we might actually reach a lot more consensus than actually doing it the way we're doing it, and so I totally support that, and as Julie said, Mrs. Hummel said,
it's a work session. You can use first.
Okay, thank you. But best practices, I mean, I don't want to be able to reach across the table and grab somebody, but on the other hand, I would really like to understand exactly where they're coming from and how they're thinking, and maybe revise my own
thinking, and I totally endorse that, that we would pursue that as a way of handling our work sessions.
I thank Dr. Beers for doing this work and for the other members for bringing this forward from VSBA. My experience is if we have important topics we're all concerned about and we all are at different points in our thinking, it is really helpful to hear not only boardmen, administrations, and staff's input, and it becomes a real consensus building, but also a problem-solving process so that we can reach one voice, which is always helpful on items. I know that we have a strategic plan and we're going to be looking at redoing that, but the board probably needs some input around that. And so those kind of open work sessions where you can do some visioning and some broader thinking is helpful as we move forward on other items. But it's helpful to be able to go all through all these policies before we go to a meeting to vote, but it'd also be helpful to have a more informal consensus building section and to ask questions a little bit more dynamically than we are currently.
So, Mr. Chair, and maybe Ms. Sirza, Dr. Constantino, I'm not sure who this question should be directed to, but is it as simple as just moving into there, the first meeting of the month? Is that?
Yeah. Let me. That's exactly what, because I talked to some of the members of the Board of Supervisors. That's what they do. They work in that room, and I believe the public is out here, and they put it up on a big screen. I would hope we wouldn't have to do that, but that's what the Board of Supervisors. One other thing that I have, because I feel strongly about it, and I did some other homework. I know, for example, and I don't know if it's available, whatever, the Stryker building has at least two rooms that can accommodate 40 to 50 people, tables, chairs. I don't know about the video capacity, but we could find out about that. I think that's an avenue that's worth pursuing because the technology, I think that part of it's already over there. So that would be, and it would be, to me, a great way to use the city's building as a, as part of the work that we do. But I don't think I'm overstepping my bounds when I say I was making an appointment with somebody who's very much involved in that project just to get a tour, but I think it would be useful to talk to city officials and see what the possibilities might be there.
Okay. Ms. Young.
I was just also going to say, since this would be a new effort on our part to redefine our work sessions, if we're having struggles and difficulty, there's an awful lot of knowledge on the board already, but the VSBA, I'm sure, would have some type of I don't want to say training or assistance to help us get our footing and to so that we could really make these sessions valuable. I think that's the issue, is that we really want them to be valuable and transparent for the public, but really getting the work done that we were asked to do.
Right. My thoughts? If we hearken back to January 5th of the organizational meeting, we had this work session, the regular meetings were here, and the work sessions were at Blair, where we were in the U, which is what we normally do it at Blair. There was some problem with having our backs to the audience, and I think we kind of worked our way through that. We got some speakers that helped to project the voices, the sounds to the audience, and also I think we improved our video capability. We had the budget work session there, and we live streamed that, and so all that was there at Blair. And the nice thing with the Blair is that instead of being around the crescent, we're in the U, where we can see each other better, and we can have better conversations. And it has been our tradition that was less formal, that was, and we can we can, there would be opportunities for us to just suspend Robert's rules and have a conversation. Instead of even having small boards, we just, let's go have a conversation. And it was very much first name basis type thing, much more relaxed, and sometimes he wouldn't even.
I mean, that's always the a right of the board is to suspend rules. Any, you know, even at a regular meeting, they could vote to do that. Yeah, I
don't mind you stealing my floor, by the way.
I don't know what.
I don't mind you stealing my floor, by the way.
But I do think I actually think Mr. Chairman that. Having tables together rather than a U, I've studied.
Right. Now the problem.
And that would be a simple thing. I just didn't know how. I mean, we could only be in Blair. What? How many more?
Well, right. That's 3 or 4 months. But
yeah. I wouldn't have any problem.
So the issues that we've had with the issue. That we have, out of respect to the Board of Supervisors, they're doing their work sessions in there. I believe our legal counsel was telling us that doesn't really meet the requirements of the Freedom of Information Act and or the public whatever the Sunshine Law is. Yeah, and cool. if we had issues with having our backs turned to the audience, being max headroom, dated myself, with video and us back in the back is kind of problematic. I do like around the table. I do like. The situation that we had at Blair, and that was kind of the vision. So, for how when we set up the calendar in January, and so I am fully comfortable with that. So, maybe at the next meeting we look and see how much longer we can be at Blair, and maybe kind of go back to Blair and kind of go back to where we were. I was looking at you, Holly. You had to look. Okay. So I'm completely comfortable with that, and I'm completely comfortable with having a much more. I work better under an informal presence anyway, so I'm completely good with that.
Is it possible to push the? I mean, those tables are movable, right? They could be pushed together, and we could reconfigure that room. Yes.
Yes. Yeah. Everything's movable in that room at Blair. So yeah, we can get all that done. Julie.
So is it possible? Our next meeting to actually have a motion and implement this for the following work session?
We can do it for the following work session. I'm not sure if we should do it as an agenda item or as a we had to kind of look at our calendar, the availability of Blair, and what all that looks like.
Can we do that before our next?
Yes, we'll have that on for the next the work session. A calendar to vote. Yeah, right. I'm sorry. Next regular meeting, which is our next meeting on March 15th, the Ides of March. So we can work to do that. All good? Good. 11.02, school board compensation. Who wants to bat lead off on this one? Mrs. Cook.
Mr. Chair, I ask that this be placed on the agenda because of a recent article that was in the Daily Press. I believe that was posted on board docs for everybody's reference. But because of that article, I just thought the timing was good to suggest to the James City County Board that they consider convening a special call meeting after the March 15th meeting to consider taking action on this topic, given that the nature of the article suggests that this body is... not compensated in a way that's comparatively equitable to other bodies that do similar work. So I just wanted to put that out there for the James City County Board's consideration. As it notes on board docs, it's one of those issues like an appointment to fill a vacancy where the boards have to convene separately. And so if the James City County Board convenes and takes action of any kind, then the city boards, the city board would follow suit automatically.
And do you just want to talk about how much the compensation is currently?
Sure. How much? It's $5,500 right now for...
Is that a month?
A year?
Oh, a year. That's right.
A year. Yes, absolutely. I'd also like to note that the members are paid by their locality, so this is not an agenda item that would come as part of the budget discussion that we had earlier, which is why it's in this part of the agenda. But so the regular members of the board get $5,500 a year, and then you, as chair, get $1,100 more than that. Is that right?
Okay.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know off the top of my head. So
I get the big bucks.
Right? It's $1,100. Yeah.
So and comparatively speaking, the James City County Supervisors, the chair is $8,800, vice chair $8,200, board members $7,000. So is there some thought as to where we should go? From we'll just go $5,500 for the normal.
Right. Well, I mean, I think if you look at the city council, council members get $7,200, so it might be smart to stay south of that. I would say perhaps $7,000, but again, I think it's a James City County board discussion. That's the figure I would throw out to start, but.
Any other board members have comments on that? Nobody wants to touch that, huh?
Well, I noticed that your county, which is a school district that is similar in size, it's not that much different now. Their members, they're compensated $9,000 a year. I didn't notice that. So, right. So even seven, I don't think would be.
Unreasonable?
No.
Mm-mm. You know how much Fairfax makes? I guess that's a
different Well, I know some cities in California, board members make $80,000 to $100,000, and each board member has a full staff.
I don't want any of that, personally. So I guess I look to the county members. Are we good with $7,000 for the... Mary, are we good with $7,000 for the members?
Just for the public, any pay raise that we decide would take place would not take place until January of next year.
January? I thought it was a fiscal year. I think it's a fiscal year in June.
I think there's a policy.
Of the 280 I have, I'm certain that there is.
I believe we need to look at the policy. And, but I think going to seven is not an issue. And part of the reason they do that is so that you're not raising your salary in the year of an election. So you would vote for this year, and then the following year it would take place. That's my understanding of the policy. I could be wrong.
So $8,500 and $7,000 for the $8,500 for the chair, $7,000 for the everybody else. Jan, do you remember when the last time this board adjusted their...
June 29th, 2005.
So it's in the last 11 years. Okay. Any of the James City County members opposed to a special meeting afterwards to take that issue up? Okay. So we'll put that on the agenda for after the regular meeting next. Maybe we should think about it before, but we'll talk about that. Oh, she gives me the evil eye. That's not a good thing. Okay, I can't do it before. Are we done with that? The board members' comments? 12.01, board members' comments. Any board members have any comments this evening? Ms. Taylor?
I would like to thank the Lafayette community for inviting us out to their schools so we could see their facilities. I really enjoyed being able to see areas where our school division can improve. I'm also very excited about Read Across America tomorrow. So,
look forward to seeing pictures of you with a cat in the hat on. Julie?
Yes, thank you. A couple things. I just want to make sure that I touch just briefly on the CIP ranking to ask that next year this process includes the entire school board for any kind of ranking that happens, just that we need to get ahead of this. If we need to figure out what the protocol is, what the requirements are by the Board of Supervisors, so that when it comes to being put in a position where we have to, although all of our items are equally important, if we're put in a position where we actually have to rank from 1 to 10, it would be nice for the community that have elected or appointed their school board members to actually have those school board members have a little voice in that for next year. So I just wanted to put that out there. I also enjoyed my tour of Lafayette High School yesterday. I have had three of my kids graduate from Lafayette High School. I was very, very familiar with the situation with the theater because I actually had climbed up there with my husband because he would help build the sets with Dr. Mayers, and I was at some, you know, the whole time I'm up there, I'm going, this is an accident waiting to happen. This is an OSHA violation right and left. So I'm really excited that things have been very, you know, made very safe for the theater department. On the other hand, I am totally sympathetic to the fact that they don't have any place to build their sets. They don't have any place to store all of their wardrobes. They don't have, they are having to schlep things from one location to another. In that building 900, and I look at that building 900, and about half of building 900 is being used by outside non-Lafayette High School student purposes. So that is a concern to me, and I really do think it's something that all of us need to look at when you've got a building that can be utilized very, very efficiently for the students of that school, not to have access to, when space is so constrained anyway, and for the students there not to have access. I really feel that's something that all of the school board and administration should look into. And I also would, because I got such a lot of information out of Lafayette High School's tour, I would really appreciate an opportunity to tour Jamestown and War Hills facilities as well. And I don't know whether that's something that Dr. Constantino could arrange or whether, I don't know. I'm throwing that out there. I don't know whether it's something that just as an individual school board member I go out there, but or if, whether it's something more organized, but I certainly would appreciate the opportunity to, now that I've seen the fields at Lafayette and now that I've seen the gymnasium, to be able to look at what is out there for Jamestown and War Hill and look at their fields and look at their lighting. I just would like to see it in person and visualize it. Along with that, sorry, I'm probably taking more than my 3 minutes, but I would like to have an assessment done of the, like, how do the athletes at the different high schools have to, what hoops do they have to jump through in order to get their practices in? Like, is it students at one high school with a volleyball team, they get to stay in their gym and they can practice from here and this time until this time, whereas students at another high school are having to, you know, drive or get transportation, have their volleyball practices start at 9 o'clock at night. I would like there to be just, I would like to know, like, what is the whole scenario for the athletes at our three high schools for all the team practice scenarios. So that's another thing I'm going to be just asking about. And I am concerned about what's the plan when we tear down the James Blair Gymnasium. What is the plan for the students that are using that gymnasium currently? What is the plan? So that's it. Thank you.
Dr. Beers?
Well, even though you took a little longer, that means I don't need to spend any time really at all. I agree with everything Mrs. Hummel said. I very much appreciated the time that the coaches and staff at Lafayette took inviting us out there. I had some pretty good notions about some of the things, some of the issues that were out there. My two kids also went through Lafayette, and I remember when Jamestown was built and Lafayette was renovated, and there were two things that were supposed to happen in both schools. Neither one did, and then Jamestown did get their auxiliary gym, and Lafayette never did get it. So, you know, that's another time, another board, another superintendent, but I understand that, if there's a little frustration out there, 1992 was how many years, a long time. So I very much appreciate that. I would also like to know how many students at Lafayette go to use the James Blair gym. So if it's shut down, how many students is that involved? I'd like to know that. I also feel strongly about the CIP. I know in the past it has been a standard procedure for the entire board to rank CIP projects. So I was concerned that I had to read about it in the newspaper. So I hope that in the future that won't happen. I don't know if it was a time constraint, whatever it might be. I just hope it doesn't happen again, because the entire board is responsible for that. So I want to make sure that doesn't happen again. And last but not least, I can't wait to go back to Matthew Whaley and Matoka to see actually two of my former students who are reading specialists out at those schools, and to share a book with kids in those schools.
Mary?
First, let me say thank you to all the staff for getting me up to speed and answering all my questions and providing me all the documents. It was really helpful. I had the most unusual experience on my orientation day. I had the privilege of being in the annex when the alarms went off all over the county for the tornado warning. So I got to meet all of the technology staff and the financial staff who was doing their training on their new system, and to spend time in the annex during that period of time. So we got to be more cordial and talk more informally, and then I have to say it was incredible. The buses for Lafayette arrived at central office because it was at dismissal time for our high schools. I think that staff needs to be given a lot of kudos for getting those buses to Magruder, those Lafayette buses to Magruder, for housing some high school and middle school students all over the district. That was an incredible action. And I know that sometimes folks are unhappy when they can't get to their children in an emergency, but I think our staff did an outstanding job in protecting them. I'd also like to thank all of the board members for the generosity with their time and meeting with me, and for any of you I haven't met with, I look forward to doing so. And finally, I'd like to say that thanks to the Gazette, I had the opportunity to speak to a lot of women friends I hadn't spoken to in a long time. And what I told them was, I am blessed to have an old face. I have family and friends that have not been as fortunate. And so having this old face is really a gift. And thank you to the Gazette, because I've talked to people I haven't talked to in a good 5-6 years. So it was really sort of a wonderful experience. But thank you for that.
Okay. Again, I want to thank Kathy Willem for yesterday. I totally enjoyed the tour of Lafayette athletic facilities, and certainly appreciate the problems that I saw that needed to be addressed there. And I was amazed at the things that they're able to accomplish and the limitations that are there. So I do want to thank you and the other people that were there to help guide us around, and that was an amazing experience. I also had the opportunity of going to operations and visiting with Marcellus Snipes and his crew.
We couldn't determine whether or not he was related to Wesley Snipes. That's still in the works.
There is a resemblance.
I'm sure he would like to be related. But while I was there, I had a tour of that amazing facility. They accomplished so much out there, and I saw the bay where they inspect and repair the buses, and my father was a mechanic, and so he would have loved that facility, and they do an amazing job of maintaining those buses and keeping things on going. I also visited the very hustling, bustling action center where they have the GPS for the buses. I never knew. I'm glad that's not in my car. I would have a ticket every minute. But the thing I did love about that was being able to see that they know where their buses are and they could answer people's questions. And the fact that they were able to get the buses off the roads in 4 minutes, all the buses were off the roads in 4 minutes the day of that tornado warning, is they really deserve a tremendous amount of praise for that. At that building, there was also nutrition services and custodial services, and I just want to commend that operations building and Mr. Snipes for the amazing job they do. And it was a lovely experience meeting Mr. Turner and all of the other people that work there. Finally, at the PTA, I was able to go to CBB where I met Dr. Heron there. There was a spaghetti dinner on February the 18th. The third grade performed a whole wonderful little program on food, and it wasn't all healthy. Well, maybe pizza is, I don't know. Mr. Kreider, who directed that, his students did a lovely job. They had a young student who was in third grade who sang in front of over 300 people. I could have never done that. I would have passed out. But that was an amazing experience. And Mrs. Hines, who directed the orchestra while we ate dinner. So we had a lovely dinner, and then the students were able to go into the gym and dance. It was a very well-operated program. And also today, I was over at Matoka. Today, March 1st, is Election Day. And I spoke with some of the electoral officials there. And one of the things, and I've also received an email from a parent, but I do propose that that we take a look at our calendar for next year and undertake a policy of closing our schools on Election Day. I was concerned about the security and safety of students. And I looked in our calendar and we did not. For next year's calendar at schools, there will be a primary on June 6th in 1917, and our schools are open that date. So if we can get ahead of the game and address that issue, I think that would be something valuable. But I do commend the staff and administration for all they do to. I've met with many people during the past week, more than I ever thought I would, and have been amazed at the professionalism of the central office. And I do thank you all for answering my questions, which are, I'm afraid, are not finished, I'm warning you, but for being so willing to work with me. I do thank you.
Mr. Chair. Ms. Miner, welcome. It's delightful to have you up here. So excited to work with you over the next several months. I wanted to, one of the things that struck me tonight in listening to citizen comments and talking to several people in the last few days about our CIP is, you know, I so far have been in the elementary, middle school bubble. So my children haven't gotten to high school yet, and I've been aware of how important a role parents and community members play at the in the education of our young people and working in partnership with the school. So it was really nice to get a window into the fact that that continues into high school, and I'm very grateful to the talented and dedicated members of our community who put in so much work to make sure that magical things happen for our high school students. So I just wanted to comment on that because it was pretty impressive. And then I wanted to echo something that Dr. Beers just said a few minutes ago about the CIP. It is this board's adopted CIP, and as we go through the process of that being vetted through the Planning Commission and then passed up to the Board of Supervisors. We've adopted it as a whole. It goes to the Board of Supervisors as such, as a whole. And I hope that we're able to work with James City County to make sure that we're able to advocate for that and ask for their serious consideration in our request. So I hope that we're able to put in that work and advocate for the CIP that we adopted.
Thank you. In conclusion, I'd like to thank the administration, Dr. Constantino, and all of our teachers and the operations staff for the and to pony off of what several board members talked about with the tornado watches and the warnings. Exceptional communication, exceptional work by our teachers, getting our kids in a safe place, exceptional work getting the buses that were on the road, off the road. Just, I think that was just an outstanding job. And, you know, that's not a small feat by the operations staff, and that should be recognized and applauded. I, too, am looking forward to Read Across America Day. I'm looking forward to the parade of characters at Stonehouse tomorrow, and I'll be at Matthew Whaley and after that. So it's going to be always a lot of fun, one of the few enjoyment periods I get in this position. Took the tour of Lafayette yesterday. I was reminded, as we took the tour through the theater, of the upcoming musicals in our high schools. For those of you who haven't had the opportunity to see our musicals, well worth the investment. Lafayette is doing The Wizard of Oz. I was able to listen to some of the practicing going on there, and it's going to be a typical Lafayette production, as all of our schools do an outstanding job in those musicals, and you kind of have to reset yourself. This is high school kids. I mean, it's really pretty amazing. Took a tour of Lafayette yesterday. I guess I asked some questions, and I got labeled as a Jamestown dad. I've got three kids who went to Jamestown. Like two of my boys won four state championships at Jamestown. I'm not going to apologize for that. In this position, I'm a WJCC dad. I care about James River. I care about Lafayette, War Hill, and all the schools. The tour of Lafayette yesterday pointed out the needs that our community has and our school system has in facilities. There are issues everywhere due to our lack of financial support of those facilities, particularly when you compare that to some of our other school divisions. The annex at Blair, I've had teachers complain to me about spending time in the annex and coming out with mold and feeling sickly and unhealthy. When you walk through Blair, you will have the stench of sewage and I think the cockroaches have civilizations there. There's a lot going on at Blair. It's a facility that is not safe and not a good place for us really to have our administration, much less to put kids at. The CIP, we did get a new process with our CIP this year. We voted on it last year. We separated it from the operational budget, which we're going to vote on in our next meeting. So we separated it out, so we made sure we gave good due consideration and have it ready for the Planning Commission. We have not previously prioritized our CIP. We put our projects, we put our years, and that went to the Board of Supervisors. The ranking process for me as one who deals with capital projects on a daily basis didn't make a lot of sense to me because we had to rank them 1 through 10 on various years and not, you know, for the whole span of the years, and it didn't make a lot of sense, but it was part of the Planning Commission's process, and they were not going to include our projects in the CIP unless we gave them that 2-day notice. So that was something that had to kind of came along rather quickly. And you know, the athletes at all of our schools travel all over the campus, all over the school system. My son played JV basketball, picked him up at Quarter Path down in the city, and I know others, more schools use Blair, and so Blair is a concern when that gym goes away of how we're going to, how our athletic directors are going to be able to have all the sports that we offer and be able to do that. That is going to be a challenge and does put, does make the auxiliary gym at Lafayette even more important. So with that, our upcoming meetings, we have a closed session March 15th. Here at 6 o'clock in the work session room, followed by a regular regular meeting on March 15th. Afterwards, at 6:30 here in the boardroom, and we are in closed session on April 12th. We're meeting the first meeting in April because of spring break, so we have a closed session here. Actually, TBD. Jan had already fixed that for us. At 6 o'clock on April 12th, followed by a work session at 6:30 afterwards. So thank you all for your good work tonight. I think it was a real productive meeting, and good job. So without objection, we're adjourned.